Hello, everybody. I am Coach Leah, the Gym Rat Diva, and in the coach's office with me today is Pamela McGee. Now, look, Pam, typically, you know, back in the day when you had to go to the coach's office,
it was probably
something wrong. So we went and did something, you know, which is followed by, oh, and by the way, go back out to the gym and see all those stairs up there. You're about to run up and down all them
and
stairs.
And do the stadiums.
Yes, indeed.
I remember
those days. Get up at 5 a.m. Who does that? Well,
yeah,
I used
people
to.
People who trying to win.
Indeed. And get some championships.
Old
some
school.
Rings.
Old school.
Indeed.
Exactly.
Indeed. Indeed. Well, today, though, however, we wanted to take a chance to talk with you about some initiatives and some things that are really that you're passionate about right now. And some things that I know we're going to be working on together here in the very near future. But so talk to me about, I think it's called the Emancipation Proclamation?
Right.
Wait a minute. Somebody already did that.
True. In 1863, Abraham Lincoln wrote the Emancipation Proclamation for African Americans. And for me, my passion has been the study of the Civil War. And there's also a season in African American history called the NADAR Movement. The NADAR Movement was right after the Emancipation Proclamation and Reconstruction, where a lot of African Americans were Republicans.
Right.
And they navigated the system because they were free men. They were in office, and they really navigated being free men.
Exactly.
But in the same sense, Southerners and Jim Crow were somewhat angry about, you know, losing the Civil War. And
of
they
course.
Also created, they had 7 years of prosperity. And then before that, they start setting up bureaucratic ways to oppress people of color.
Right, right.
And so when I talk about my Emancipation Proclamation, I say that now in the year 2015, I feel that we are once again in a civil war. A civil
wow.
war as far as instead of it being, you know, slavery and should slaves be free, now I feel like we have institutionalized and not institutionalized.
Okay, okay.
Because we do have African Americans of wealth. But now we have a choice. Do you want to be institutionalized or not institutionalized?
Mm-hmm.
And now the civil war amongst our community is the haves and the have-nots.
Yes, yes, indeed, indeed.
And so for me, my passion has been what separates me and you and others who really looked at education as a form of freedom. You know, when we look at education, whether it be through the internet, through YouTube, through reading books,
right,
through getting a degree,
right,
I feel like education is my Emancipation Proclamation, and that all of us have to form not only education, though, but also what I find, and I talk to my children about it, how we have lowered our standards as African Americans.
Right, right.
So also when I say education is my Emancipation Proclamation, and home training, there are some things that I just would not do because Diane, my mother, I still hear her voice, rest in peace, mommy, but she would put her foot up, you know, and
okay,
didn't care.
Right, exactly, exactly. And so I really feel like, too, that when we think about all of these things you're talking about, information is power.
Mm-hmm.
And the opportunity that we have to help spread information through education, and you would think that that's the same thing. It not always is.
It's true. and also, I just don't think anyone has an excuse to be not educated now. You got YouTube, you got Google, you got Instructables, Udemy, Lynda.com. You
right.
can actually educate yourself through the internet if you want to.
You really could.
With the, you know, hopefully we'll end up having net neutrality. So there's no excuse because, you know, I don't know about your age, but I didn't have Google. I didn't have YouTube.
Wait a minute. So you're going to go ahead and let me let it seem like I'm that much younger than you? Bless you, my child. No, we are in the same era, which I love that.
Right. And I came up when we still had, did you have a word processor?
Yes. See? No. Did you have a typewriter?
Typewriter, right. I was right into the typewriter. Then my mama bought me a word processor.
Okay, we really thought that we
I
were
had
doing
evolved.
Something, girl, okay?
But really, what's dear to my heart is when we see what's happening in, you know, Baltimore, and we see what's happening with police brutality, and I had an epiphany that I feel like what we're feeling right now is we got more African-American men of color, not only red and brown,
mm-hmm.
I mean black and brown,
right.
that are incarcerated. Now we have more men incarcerated than we had slaves Emancipation Proclamation. And now that we have like 60% of African American men do not graduate from high school. So now, right. if you don't have a high school diploma and a criminal record, you are really preparing yourself to go right back to the penitentiary. Not University of Penn. I'm talking about the University of Penitentiary.
Penitentiary, right, exactly.
And
exactly.
when we see police brutality and we see police going to capture African-Americans through brutality, all they're doing is they're the bounty hunter going back to find another slave to take him back
Absolutely.
To the plantation.
Absolutely.
And when we look at prisons now that are producing gross national product, and when you produce gross national product for cheap labor, 60 cents on the dollar, and then when we look at this argument about immigration, the real argument about immigration reform is corporate America and corporations do not want legalized immigration, because then once you legalize these individuals, they can demand certain wages.
Absolutely. And so now once the labor that you have that was
free or
I can pay you anything pennies because, on the dollar
are
now.
Because I know that you're illegal.
Absolutely.
And we look back on the history of slavery. The issue was not if it was humane or not or inhumane. The issue was in southern states, they were saying, what are we going to do with all this money we're making? And where will we ever get this cheap labor?
Right.
It was about money. So now that we look at prisons and they're becoming privatized.
Yes. And so money making entities.
And there is a company, CCA Corrections Corporation of America.
Yes.
They are a company that's traded on the national New York Stock Exchange.
Right.
Now to think of that, you make money on incarcerating people of color.
Right.
And it's traded on the stock market.
Exactly.
So the stock price is based on how many African Americans or people of color that you incarcerate.
Absolutely.
That in itself is a conflict of interest.
It should be.
It should be. Because you're making money off of incarcerating individuals.
Exactly.
And not only that, last year, the same company, not only we talk about immigration, they also made $2 billion last year sending immigrants back to the country.
Wow.
So deported people. So when they talk about Obama doing so much for this immigration or whatever, it was the same thing that he made all of these, the Dream Team and the Dream initiatives, but he also was the same time that they had more people deported back to where they came from. And so when we look at our prisons, the prisons are made up of people who look like me.
Yes.
Brown and black. Yet in our school systems are even more impoverished than ever. And there's a study that says that they determine how many prisons that they build by
based on how many
the grades
kids.
Of all third graders and their aptitude tests on standardized
absolutely.
Testing.
And their literacy rates. Absolutely. And this is the reason why, as an educator, former educator, I have just been on the forefront, in my opinion, to try to eradicate just literacy, period, because, you know, we
illiteracy.
Did I say literacy? We want to eradicate literacy.
Because there's a C-O-N space.
Exactly.
C-O-N space.
It's a problem. Oh, goodness gracious. But and then you wonder why, and I'm sure that you guys viewing this right now are wondering why. Now, why do you have these two former basketball players, basketball executives, you know, here talking about Emancipation
education.
Proclamation, education, you know, history. It's because all of these things matter in dealing with how we're going to be able to impact the future. Because literally, and you guys know, my belief is that the things that we do through sport, through athletic activity, really does parlay into how the world operates. Because these people that are, these young people, and most athletes start out as young athletes, you grow up through athletics, through teamwork, and you know, a lot of these skills that you embody within athletics are things that are life skills that you then foster as you're going into your professional life, whether it's in sport or any other profession.
Exactly.
And so if we're not helping the mindset, helping to frame the mindset, helping to train the mindset now as while they're young, then what are we doing?
Exactly. And for me, basketball changed my life. I mean, You know, when I came up from school, I had a white coach. He was in the hood. He spent so much time with me. My mama went up to school. Who's this white man with my children?
Okay, right.
But yet he was the first coach to really form my substance, or I say the core of who I am. Because mm-hmm. he would always say, it's not if you win or lose, it's how you play the game. Mm-hmm. And he always said, if you're not going to play hard, if you're not going to give your best, then don't play at all.
Exactly.
And all people are good people. And that, you know, you look at the core of the character of the person, not the color of their skin. And I learned that at a young age, 8 and 9. And this was this white man in the hood that taught me how to love all people.
Right, right.
And not be racist. And to just look for the character in people and not just define people by their color. Well, because I had that experience.
Exactly. And I don't want to take us too far off track, but you know, we can talk about whatever we want to talk about. I really feel like, again, something that sports does is it really does connect people of all races, all ethnicities, all socioeconomic statuses. There's something about that ball. If you roll a ball in a gymnasium, you just roll it in there, and kids of all different colors are in that gym, they're going to find a way to play a game. They're absolutely going to, well, there might be one bully and be like, it's my ball, I'm taking it home. But right. more than likely, it doesn't matter. It doesn't even matter if they don't speak the same language. They're going to figure out that
sports
ball
is like a universal kind of universal language in itself.
It is.
That we
absolutely.
All can come together. You know, I was on the Olympic team, and I have friends all across the world because of that experience. And more importantly, I like about sports, it teaches you not to quit, to fight hard. I try to teach parents, especially women, to teach your daughters, if they play sports, they're found not to be victims of domestic violence. I know
yes.
for me,
teenage pregnancy.
Exactly.
When I started my foundation years ago, North Minneapolis had the highest instances of teenage pregnancy in the country. So this little small community. So it was crazy, and it was amazing to me. And I didn't start it so that I would eradicate teenage pregnancy. I just was like, this is a cool program. If we get some girls involved, maybe they would enjoy it and be able to see some of the things that I've been able to see, you know, coming out of the hood through this sport, right? Mm-hmm. But it was amazing. I found out through the Hennepin County, I was on a health and communities board. Mm-hmm. I found out through those members that in less than 2 years, it had pretty much erased the fact that they were on the top 10 for it being an issue mm-hmm. just from having the activity.
Yeah.
That in itself.
And so it boils down to, you know, education, being mm-hmm. exposed. I think education, the power of it is an exposure. We expose our children to different ways of life, different people. And just when you talk about education, I really feel like education is the firm emancipation. Now, I am not just an avid person that everybody has to go to college. I think sometimes we eliminate a whole population just because we believe that everyone has to go to college. No, I think some people can have trades, like to be a builder, to be a carpenter, to be a plumber. They make quite a few money, to be a nurse.
Absolutely.
And I think that, but education, because there's a lot of wealthy, wealthy millionaires who did not take the track of education, meaning like they did not go to college, but they will tell you that they had to learn the hard way through the hard school of hard knocks.
True.
Through experiential education.
Right.
Working twice as hard for individuals who went the school route. And I feel that now we're looking at, when I was talking about the separation of our people, mm-hmm. you know, some people call it the house Negroes and the field Negroes. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And there's a movie called Color Lines. And what he determined was they went and looked at these individuals in Atlanta who had 3 generations, and now the 3rd generations were living in $600,000, $500,000 homes.
Wow.
They were doctors and lawyers. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Then they looked at the same population that grew up in the projects, and they had 3 generations of projects. What they determined was the ones that migrated from the South, who came up to the South, they was under the New Deal Act, and they had to have a lot of kids, because in the South, if you had a lot of kids, you could work the farms.
Right.
The others went up North, and they put their schools in, they paid for education.
Right.
They put their kids and they saved their money, mm-hmm. they lived beneath their means, mm-hmm. and paid for education for their children, those
right.
who became college educated.
Yes.
And then they made an investment in their children in reference to education, and now their children are affluent. So that's the difference. Not that I quote Jesse Jackson, but it was Jesse Jackson that said, he said, it takes a whole village to raise a child, mm-hmm. but sick villages raise sick children.
Yes. Yes, indeed.
And I feel like for me, if we're going to stop the institutionalized of African-American men primarily and our people, it's going to come where we have to change our mindset.
Absolutely.
There was a time where I know for me, there were certain things I just couldn't do because I would hear Diane's voice.
In the back of your head.
Right, that's Diane's daughter. There's some things that you just could not tolerate because I had, that my mother always said excellence. You know, I don't know about you, but my mother was an old school mother. We had to get up at 5 o'clock in the morning and clean the whole house.
Wow.
You know, every Saturday we got up and we cleaned the whole house at 5 o'clock in the morning. And then you got finished about 8 and then you go back to bed and then you go do what you had to do. But so that taught me discipline. That taught me discipline. And no matter where we lived, I mean, even today when I wasn't always beneficial of the quality of life that I have now.
Okay.
Hallelujah. Back in the good. Even exactly. When I had apartments, I would go in and clean the apartment after I moved in.
But you know what? There's something that's really prophetic about when you say that too, and even biblical about when you say that, because you can't really have or want, attain or sustain something more when you're not taking care of what you have.
Be faithful of a few things.
There you go.
And there's also, or not only that, also you have to invest.
Absolutely.
You know, I look at corporate America. Sometimes we hate corporate America, but I do put it into my own business practices. You know, and what we do, and I'm not going to say, but in Jewish communities, you have to intern. They make you intern for free for a year, and then you get a job.
Right.
The reason why they do interns is because of the fact they want to see if you can make an investment.
Right.
Now, if you make the investment and the sacrifice, then they hire you.
And speaking of interns, you know, we've got a few that work with me here at KJLZ, and I tell them all the time that interns, especially in the media industry, are very valuable because you're actually engaging in activities that you're going to do when you get paid. And the more available you are as an intern, the more opportunities you have to learn. I haven't talked to anybody, and this would be including myself, that has done anything really profitable or made any major gains in media that didn't spend a lot of time as an intern.
And also, not only that, when you look at interns and investing and working for somebody for free, not only that, in the media industry, people move all the time. So you just never know who you intern. And they say, well, I got a new position. And because you intern me is who you know, and they will move you to that position.
But I'm seamlessly.
I am just a really a firm believer in seed and harvest.
Absolutely.
And I also believe, you know, that God does not bless individuals in the fact that if you are not willing to first sacrifice. Right. I think God gives you a testing point. I'm a firm believer even in that God, you always got to respect your first gifts. I firmly believe if you cannot respect the first gift, your body and your soul that God gives you authority over, I don't see how, I think God says, well, how am I going to bless you in your finances? Well, look at this gift that I gave you.
Right.
And you can't take care of that. I always challenge people. I said, how many fat CEOs do you see?
It's very rare.
Very rare.
Very, very rare.
And there's a constant pattern of non-institutionalized people. They work out and they take care of their body because they understand if I'm laying on my back, I'm also a breast cancer survivor.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Congratulations.
Yeah, I mean, is that what you say when you're breast Do you say
congratulations for surviving breast cancer.
Okay. Thank you, my sister. So I guess it's congratulations
it is.
That you're alive.
Well, for sure.
Yeah.
Because, man, I did not know that.
Yeah.
Wow.
So through that experience, though, I was laying on my back and I was praying to God. And, you know, I'm a fighter. I mean, I'm a survivor.
Oh, yeah. For sure.
I just, you know, I'm always saying, you can't take me out. It might be a 7 count. They'll be like, 6, 7. you shouldn't have let me out. I'm back up and I'm going to keep fighting. But it was devastating to have breast cancer, though. It was devastating because my body has never just let me down.
Right, exactly.
I mean, I could always say, okay, I'm getting ready to go back overseas, make some more money playing basketball or do whatever. It was always like, okay, my go-to, all right. And then when I got breast cancer and it had no genetic disposition, and then I'm like, well, wow, this is some stuff that can, like, take you out, like, kill you. You know, and I was so devastated. And then, but it also taught me when I was laying in a hospital bed, and I'm an entrepreneur. I'm an emancipated executive operating in all of God's gifts.
Nice.
In EEO.
Okay.
And so, but it dawned on me. I said, if I'm not healthy and I'm laying here on my back, I can't make any money.
There you go.
You know, and so, and God showed me you must maintain your first gift, and that's your body and the gift that God gave you. And, you know, and through prayer and through the healing, the doctors couldn't understand how fast I healed. And people were like, well, ain't you depressed that you got cancer? And my friend today, my best friend told me, he said, you know, you never talked about it. You was always positive. And I said, because I heard a word from God.
Yes.
God told me you gonna be all right. Mm-hmm. I got too much work for you to do.
And there you go.
And I just prayed, and I just believe also that cancer is like a demon. Mm-hmm. If you allow it to devour, because the body, the gift is designed to heal itself. Mm-hmm. And I try to tell people, they say, well, you know, I'll be 53, I think, something like that. And they say, well, you know, you look good for 53. And they say, well, do you eat right? Do you work? I say, yeah, I do that too. But the main thing that keeps people healthy is eliminate toxic people.
Oh my goodness, yes.
If you eliminate anything, eliminate toxic people. It is not cancer, it is not diabetes, it is not heart disease that kills Black women primarily. It's toxic people. Wayward children. Men, children too old to be living up in your house, and you should have put them out.
Hello. Hello.
and toxic,
get your own house.
Toxic men who are toxic terrorists that do not understand your beauty, your love, and your power, that God has called you to be a queen.
Right.
And if he cannot be a king to celebrate your queendom, then boo, you got to be all right with being by yourself and walking one with the Creator.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
You know, and I think after I turned 50, that's when the light came on that I was all woman. Mm-hmm. Can you say all woman? Hallelujah.
Yes, and I just passed that mark myself, and I'm happy to say that. And people tell me the same thing. Wow, you're 50. I can't believe you're 50 years old. And I'm like, you know, just live. Just live.
And I tell people, if I died and came back as a man, I'd be a transvestite. I love being a woman so much.
See, right?
And then I tell a joke, too. I say, if Caitlyn Jenner says he was always a woman in his soul, I say, well, I'm a man in my soul. Pay me like a man then.
Exactly. And see, we won't even get into that topic because
that'll be a whole nother show.
That's a whole nother show. But I'm just saying, make sure you check us out.
Yeah, but in my gender, in my soul, I'm just like a man. I want to make the same amount of money as a man, but I get to still sleep with men. Okay. See, yeah, but yes. You know, Caitlyn Jenner, he's, you know, wants to be a woman inside, but he still is attracted to women.
I know, which that.
So I'm telling you, I'm coming out too in my soul and in my mind. I want to be a man, so pay me like a man. I want my bank account to reflect that of a man.
And it is really.
But I still like to be intimate with a man.
Okay. Just make sure that's clear.
Yeah,
make
it's sure too that, much because I am all woman. That's true. But yes. I do. I love being a woman. And I just think, and you know, that's really my mission in life, is to just touch as many women as I can to emancipate them and let them walk in their queendom and let them know that they're beautiful from the inside out.
Exactly.
And that we don't have to do all of that to please other people. And we can walk in our queendom. We don't have to reduce ourselves. We don't have to reduce ourselves to prove that we're intelligent. We don't have to reduce ourselves if we dress nice. We don't have to reduce ourselves just because we're smart, intelligent, and paid.
And paid. It's okay to pay us. It really, really is. Because really, in all actuality,
because we are emancipated executives operating in all our gifts. It's called EEOs.
Indeed, indeed. When we are gifted in that way financially, because we are the, what is the word? The nurturers. What do? We nurture. We plant the seeds.
One of the best business principles that my mentor told me, and it has really saved my life when it comes to my business. As Black women, and I can't speak for other women, but as I think it's really a universal law for women, when you make decisions, mm-hmm. and I don't know about other women because I'm not that type of sister. You know, some women equate sexual relationships with their financial relationships. Just because you have a man that knows how to make love to you, make you feel good, that has something to do with my money. I'm not that sister. No, seriously. You know, I'm comfortable with my sexuality, and, you know, somebody can make love to me and I could be comatose for 2 days. What they got to do with my money? No, I'm serious. Right. And I don't really. Right. So I think that I'm like an emancipated executive operating all God's gifts, because I really don't understand that. I just feel like, you know, and I don't feel like because I'm successful that my success has anything to do with my man. Like, right. I don't have to reduce myself for you to feel good about yourself as a man.
Right.
And I expect you to understand that I do what I do. And if I choose in my relationships, if I have a man, I say, you know, like, and I'm that sister. You know, I was dating a man for like a year and a half. And so we broke up on a Wednesday and I was out on a date on a Friday. He was like, now, how are you going to be on a date on a Friday? We've been together for almost 2 years and you broke up with me on a Wednesday. I said, boo boo, you were the franchise player.
Okay.
I told you was the franchise player because I allowed you to be the franchise player. But you got waived, and there was always some brothers on the bench that wanted to get in the
game.
They were waiting for you to drop the ball.
And not even just that. You know how whenever you know you choose, your minutes might be minimized or might be, you make everything you can
you know,
for those
minutes. Never told you that they was off the bench, that I didn't let them in the game because you were the franchise player.
And look, and as a coach, you always tell your players, you don't never know when you're going to be put in
pulled
the game,
up.
But
you
be
never
ready.
Know. You never
be ready,
know when you're going to get pulled up.
Be ready. Maybe optimize your moments.
Hello. but it is. I mean, I really do. I think that this time in my life, I just love my essence, my aura. I just think... After 50, and I know young girls are saying, really? But after 50, this is
really.
The time in life where your mind, body, and soul just all come together.
Especially when, I'm writing about this. You'll receive the message here very, very soon in a letter I'll be sending you. But it's so important that if we've basically, I don't want to say sacrificed, but devoted our lives to healthy, active lifestyles, to be ever, in my opinion, to be rewarded. And that's, my sister, why you were rewarded with, you know, full recovery and remission of your cancer, because you put in the time early on by living a healthy and active lifestyle.
So alcohol and drug free.
So now you're reaping the benefits.
And
of
eliminating
that.
Toxic people.
And that too. But no, and that is really, really important. It's so, so important. And sometimes those toxic folks don't necessarily reveal themselves, but and I don't want to get too deep and spiritual here, but if you're really in tune with your discernment, they'll reveal themselves. You don't even have to be worried about that they'll reveal
it to
you.
I don't know. Because sometimes as women, if we're broken, you know, my pastor used to say that the fly, I just thought, I do a sermon on Tamar, the story of Tamar, when she went to go feed her brother and he raped her.
Right.
All Tamar's perspective was, I want to feed my brother
that
because he's sick.
Exactly.
I want to feed my brother. And she was raped. So sometimes bad things happen to good people.
Oh, it absolutely does.
But then God teaches you to forgive.
True.
And I try to tell people there's two types of forgiveness. And I'm not just telling you, this was for me.
All right.
There's a forgiveness by justice, where if I hit you, coach, you'll say, oh, I'm so sorry, coach. I shouldn't have hit you.
Right.
And you're like, it's all right, because I justified it's forgiveness by justice. It's like, you apologize, I'm good.
Right.
But then sometimes we have a time in our life when God says you need forgiveness by emancipation. God gave me that, not that freed my soul, because sometimes I have to forgive people, not because I want to, but because I want to be emancipated so I don't have that junk in my spirit.
Yeah, but no, it's freeing for you.
Yes.
And, you know, a lot of times, it is okay to be selfish in that regard. You know what? I'm going to forgive you not because I think you deserve to be forgiven. It's because it's all about me and my freedom.
And I don't want that anger, bitterness.
Exactly.
And sometimes we are destroying our children. And this is, I'm going to tell any black women, you are destroying your children by keeping them away from their father, by discussing negative energy about him, because God reveals truth.
Absolutely.
He reveals
and
truth.
And time heals. And I am a true testament.
And you have to let
that.
Your children see the truth for themselves.
Yes, absolutely.
They will be exposed and they will come to that truth on their own.
Absolutely.
All our responsibility is, and I used to pray to God for this, is just to be a good mother.
Yes.
And if you married, to be a good wife.
Yes.
And then your mate or your partner or your soulmate, you give them to God and you pray for
them. You do.
And you stand holy before them and you just stand in your goodness and your kindness as a woman.
Mm-hmm.
And you watch God move. I know he will move.
Absolutely. I'm a true testament to that as well.
Because never underestimate the power of a woman.
Never.
Ever.
Never, ever.
Ever.
You guys will figure out what that means very, very soon. But thank you so much for joining me here today, Pamela. This has been great. A great segment. In the coach's office with Coach Leah.
See, even in the coach's office, we talk about women's issues.
Oh, most definitely. especially if it's my office and I'm a woman. But anyway, tune in very, very soon for another segment of The Coach's Office. Have a good day.